you should be good to print without any supports. But if it slants even more down or like go to like 80 degrees or 70 degrees, you should like the slicing software should automatically put some supports or something underneath to actually go up. And when the slant layer is being printed, you have something on the base to actually support it, because you can't have the build platform all the way to the house. Yeah, I'll actually play. Yeah, let's play the video. All right, so like FPM. So there are like many methods with which you can design a hardware. So the common one is actually the Cartesian system, where you have X and Y axis to the build platform, and you have the Z axis to the extruder assembly. So that's one thing. But there is also another method which is called Delta, or that's non-Cartesian method, where you have three orthogonal axes to the build platform, which simultaneously moves up and down to articulate the extruder head in like whatever position that you want. So yeah, so these are some good points that you should talk about. And so how does it extrude? Coming to that, so the filament is being extruded through something which is called an extruder assembly, or a hot end, or a heater block, or you can call it any way you want. So it's nothing. It's like a ceramic heater cartridge which is locked onto a brass nozzle or something which is softer and doesn't like damage the molten plastic. And you have a stepper motor which is attached on top, which pushes off the filament all the way to the build platform. So as you can see, the blue part is actually the cooled filament from the reel, and that's being pinched down with the stepper motor onto the guide groove, and then that pushes it all the way through the hot end, and it extrudes at a width of the nozzle. So one thing I would like to point out is layer height is something which affects the solution of the part, but there is also one other factor which limits the XY resolution of the part. So the plastic filament could be 1.75 millimeters in diameter, but you don't have to use 1.75 and in the extrusion. You can actually like funnel that or have a nozzle to compress that to say 200 microns, 400 microns, 500 microns, etc. So it doesn't have to be 1.75 millimeters. And yeah, so these are something.
What a variable.
So these are some like timeline of FDM machines. So the one on the left is actually the one of the first FDM machines, which was developed by Stratasys. Yeah, this is like probably like 20, 25 years old. And then, so at that time, Stratasys, they had a locked patent, and nobody else could like replicate all those ideas. But when that patent expired in 2009. So what happened was all this open source community people, they gathered up and they decided to make their own knockoff version of FDM machines, and then started a group or a club called RepRap. It stands for Rapid Prototyping Machines. So they make open source designs, open source software, open source hardware plans and things with which you can, or anybody can, get parts and assemble them and make their own printers. I mean, I would say most of the Chinese and off-the-shelf, low-cost FDM printers actually follow the RepRap builds and designs. That being said, let's move on to the next technology. It's called SLA or DLP. So this is something which was invented much before the FTM, the fusion deposition model. SLA stands for stereolithography or like selective laser, like you can call it anyway, but it generally referred to as stereolithography. And there is another similar or analogous technology which is called DLP or digital light projection printing. So they both have like 90% of the same attributes with like a few changes to the design on how they print or the method on how they actually do the layer curing. This is actually a method of 3D printing where in this method, you don't have any like plastic spools or something that you extrude. So you have a vat or a trough of UV curable photopolymer, which if exposed to a certain wavelength of UV light, it actually starts to cure and become solid. So it transitions from liquid to solid when exposed with a certain UV wavelength. All right, so you have that thing which transfers from liquid to solid, but how do you actually print objects with that? So if there is a way to move the laser or something that emits the UV source in the path of the object that you want to print, you actually end up making your own solid object in three dimensions. So the first image on the left is for a system called SLA or lithography. So this one uses a UV laser, usually 4 or 5 nanometer, that then like bounces off a scanning system which consists of 2 mirrors changes the laser spot from X and Y to whatever location that you want. So if you can carefully coordinate that movement, depending on the sliced object that you made, you actually end up making a high resolution print after you complete all the layers. I'm getting a lot of disturbance.
Kindly mute your microphone, please. Everyone, kindly mute your microphone, please. It's very disturbing.
Thank you.
Right, can we start now? Yeah. Can you hear me now? Just like muted myself. Perfect. Yeah. So I said about an SLA, which is so you have a vat of photopolymer or some. It's a liquid which actually polymerizes or becomes solid when exposed to a certain UV wavelength. So what happens is there is like a laser source which then bounces off a scanning mechanism or like a two-axis a mirrors. So when you carefully coordinate the movement, you actually you can plot the laser spot in any position you want. So if you can control that depending on your sliced model or like the sliced path, you actually end up creating a complete solid layer. And as you like develop that for like several layers, you end up getting a solid object. So that's the principle of vat polymerization or like SLA. But so somebody thought, what if we could do the same thing without a laser, or like something which is like constant and like which is like much faster than SLA? So that's called DLP, where this is like the kind of the same technology, but the only difference is this one doesn't have a laser or like a scanning source. So it has a DMD projector. So DMD is a digital micromirror device. So it's a new like kind of projector developed by Texas Instruments. So that actually it uses like so it's a chip which has millions of tiny mirrors, like individually can actuate on and off, bounce light from a source. So this DMD chip is being bombarded by UV light from a UV source, which is at a certain angle. And then this chip actually projects whatever the light it gets, following the pattern of the spliced object onto the build platform. So you get the same vat polymerization, but with a single exposure rather than scanning a laser beam X and Y. So that's how the DMD works. The good thing about SLA and TLP is it's slightly expensive than FDM, but it's much cheaper than the rest of the technologies. And the very good point about these is it has like so much resolution where you couldn't even like tell the difference between the layers. So you can actually print objects that are like 10 microns high and all they go up like 100 microns. So I mean, I would say at 100 microns, you might not able to like tell out the layers, but if you go like 50 or 25, that's it. It becomes like an object which resembles an injection molded object. So it's that good, and it's complexity free. You don't have to make any dies or molds to actually cast out the object. It just like comes out of nowhere. So you design an object, slice it, and send it for print, and you get the same object at the same resolution that you need in just like a day or max, depending on your print size. And yeah, so the third image on the right is a printer called Form2, which is made by a company called Form Labs. So Form Labs, so they are the people who actually made the SLA technology, desktop portable. So they make desktop printers where you can buy one and like just have it close to your computer and like do it at your home. You don't need like labs or like industrial facilities to actually do the printing. So yeah, that's something I wanted you guys to know. And let's go on. All right, so next. It's still the same thing. It's layer by layer, but you make the layer solidify in like different manner. So this the next technology that I would like to speak is it's called material jetting. So material jetting has several different sub varieties. So the main two things that I would like to focus is polymer jetting and binder jetting. So let's talk about polymer jetting first. So on the last slide, so you guys know that you have a material or a liquid that actually becomes solid when exposed to certain wavelength of UV. So instead of having it in a big vat and you like cure layer by layer, so why don't we actually spray it out onto a build platform and then cure it after you set the shape? So that's like simplest way of putting what a PolyJet is. So the polymer jet, which is also called PolyJet, is a 3D printing method where you take this photocurable ink or resin and then jet it out through tiny nozzles. So this on a head. So this head is very similar to the ones you see in color. Paper color printers, so the HP, Epson, and like a lot of stuff. It's actually like almost the same thing, with like a small modifications on the passes and stuff you do. So what it does is, for the first layer, it acts as a 2D printer. So it's just like you print something on a build platform. But instead of taking the print out, what you do is you continue doing that for each layer by lowering the build platform down and down, and at last you get like a final product without a in a dry fashion, with like the problem about SLA is after you print it, you have to take it out from the vat and you have to dip it in isopropyl alcohol to remove unwanted ink, and like you have to put that in a curing box to completely cure it. So with this PolyJet, what happens is you don't have to clean it or do anything. So you just like get it out, and then yeah, you're good to use. And one more advantage of PolyJet is you can have four or six materials at the same time. So you can have a model material which prints out the base structure that you want, and then you can have provisions for adding dissolvable supports, or to say if you want to print something that is like so weird and it needs like a lot of supports. So I mean, yeah, so 3D printing like it needs something underneath to support the layer on the top. So you can't have that in the model material, then it will become a solid. So on the image on the left, you see like a yellow and white mixed object. So the one on the white is actually the supports, and one on the yellow is model material. So what it does is it prints both of them simultaneously, and then you take this part out, and then you can either like dissolve it or just like peel it off, or just wash it. Just put it in like a vat of water and then like rinse it. That support usually dissolves away. So that's how this works. And I actually forgot to tell you something. So you know that the jet actually jets out the polymer, which falls on the build platform and builds a layer. But how does it cure it? What it does is so the jet is actually the UV light on right. The jet moves from like right to left. The UV also moves from right to left. So as the material is being dropped, the UV light cures it. So that's how you solidify each layer. Yeah, so the image on the right is actually a bit more useful for you to visualize. Yeah, so it's the same thing, but you see there's like support material on a different tank and build material on a different tank, and you have two print nozzles and a UV. That's how. So you drop in material and then you cure it with the UV. And this the resolution of this is similar to SLA and TLP. You can go like from 10 microns to 100 microns, or some cases even more than that, but it depends on the viscosity of the build material. Right, so that's polymer jetting. Yeah, the next jetting is called a binder jet. So this is it's completely different. It's not the photocurable UV resin anymore. So this one is just powder. So it's just like a gypsum or some kind of like a powdery material. So what this does is it uses the same jetting nozzle, but instead of jetting out the material, it jets out a kind of a binder or a glue. So that actually bonds the powder in place. So what the platform does is it starts with a thin layer of powder, say like a 20, 30 micron layer of powder, and then the print head moves in whatever path that you want, and it drops in glue and it solidifies that. And the build platform goes down, the recoater roller actually drops another layer of powder. And then the head starts to move and again like glues together whatever section that you need to be cured. So after you do this for like X amount of layers, then what happens is you don't see anything. So then you have to use like a vacuum pump and then suck out all the powder on the outside. Then you're left with the solid printer part. And one of the best things about BinderJet is, so until like this point, so you've only seen printers that can print like single color or maximum two, that's all. But what if you could print something in like full CMYK colored parts? So what this printer does is there are like some variants of this where they use a tandem inkjet or the same kind of color head that normal like paper color printer uses. And then as the binder is being jetted out, the printer also jets out whatever color for the part is. So you can actually print parts that have like full color. So you can actually completely visualize whatever you design. So one of the drawbacks of this is, so since it's being powder and you dip it through some kind of like a percolative sealant, the whole thing is so hard and it's brittle. So you can't use this for a real world application. So the best you can use this is for like demonstration and for aesthetics. So it's more like a, what do you call it? A designer's kind of printer. So if you design something new or like design a color scheme, you can actually print that out and see how the color scheme would look like in the real world. And that's all. But you can't use this for conventional parts that other printers are using. So the layer height for this is similar. It depends on the grain size of the powder and the level, how thin the leveling roller can go. All right, so this is, now we are getting to the industrial grade. So this stuff, so this technology is called SLS. It stands for Selective Laser Sintering. So this technology is like, it's very similar to SLA, but instead of curing the ink, it actually sinters or melts and coalesces the powder. So what SLS does is it's a 3D printing method where they use a high power laser beam or a spot, which is like several watts, like which has several watts of power. And then that beam is actually scanned over a bed of a powder material, which could be nylon or any other thermoplastic, or it could be even metal. So metal can also be printed with this technique. So it uses some of the concepts of the SLA. So it has a scanner, mirror scanner, it has a laser source, and this also uses some of the binder jet concepts. So it has the powder bay, it has the leveling roller. So it's a kind of a hybrid technology between SLA and binder jet. So the good thing about this is it can print metals, plastics, and since the whole thing is being submerged in powder, it doesn't need any supports for supporting the hover ranks. So you saw the FDM printer, it needs supports for printing flange structures, but this is the whole thing is being submerged inside a vat of powder or a trough of powder. So the powder actually self-supports all the printed objects. So you don't have to add any additional supports to your print. So, yeah, so on the middle image, the one with the blue border, you see, so C, the one depicted with C is actually the laser beam source, and that like focuses on the spot D. So the D is like the material spot, which actually, as the laser bombards on it, the spot actually melts, and it coalesces with the layer underneath and the around it. So you solidify that powder. So, and you do this for each successive layer for you to get a print. Yeah, so the layer, like, so I forgot to say something very important. So all of these 3D printing techniques, it depends on two major things. What is your, like how you export your CAD model. So you can have it in STL or OBJ and like any other like supported models or export formats. And then how do you slice it? So, I mean, everything is a slicing process. So the 3D, what I would say is 3D printing is, it's repeating 2D printing over like several layers to get the final object. So it's nothing complex. So you actually print it back to back again and again to actually get that. So everything has a mediator's part, which is called the slicing software. So every printer has its own slicing software. What that slicing software does is it takes the CAD model that you import and they apply a special kind of algorithms and steps to actually decimate, like cut those triangles and get individual slices and toolpath and for creating the layer geometry. Yep, that's this, and we'll go to the next. Okay, so this is something interesting, which is not out yet. So it's a technology that's being developed. So this was developed by a company which is called Vader Systems in Buffalo, New York, but they actually sold this technology to a company called Xerox Corporation. So Xerox actually owns this patent now, and they are like investing a lot to make this happen. So what this does is instead of having a powder bed and like sintering the powder to get the object, so why can't we jet out molten metal and then do the printing? So the whole thing would become solid and it doesn't have to be post-processed or like re-sintered to completely solidify or anything. So yeah, so a team of two actually came up with this idea where what they use is they have a high temperature, like a small like heating chamber or a ceramic heating chamber, and they put the source material there and then heat it up and make it into a puddle of molten material. And then what they do is they have like huge magnetic flux coils which like operate at like 200 amps, 2000 volts. So for each pulse, what happens is it creates a kind of a eddy current inside, which actually compresses the material, a molten material, and jets out say 100 micron droplets. So, and then what they do is they guide these droplets over a build platform to construct the layer geometries and then do it over like successive layers to get the control. So this is like something just being developed, and I hope this reaches the market soon. Right. These are some references. I think you guys will get the presentation after this session, so you can actually like refer to these if you need need to know about anything. All right, it's time for questions.
Hello, sir. Is it possible to customize the existing printer for a bioprinting of the scaffolds?
It depends. So, what do you mean by existing printer? So, what kind of printer that you have?
So that's what we are asking. So can you list some of the printer that is possible to customize to print the scaffolds, bone scaffolds?
Any printer can be customized, but it depends on the resolution that you need. And so I would say for scaffolds, you can actually look at some of the printers from SLA and DLP. So these are something that can print far superior resolutions than others. So, I mean, we are actually using DLP to make our organ scaffolds, or like trying to make our organ scaffolds, because organ scaffolds, they need a resolution of like within like a micron. So there is no technology yet to do that. So we are actually relying on DMP, like DLP, to scaffolds. I would say the DLP printers can be customized to actually print bone scaffolds.
Can we combine the polymeric materials while
Yeah.
making the scaffolds?
There are two ways. So first is you print a polymer and then add cells or like the bo bo like cells to it. Or there is another way where you can mix polymer and then mix polymer with cells and then do the printing. But the drawback of the second method is since we are using UV, so the cells they don't like being exposed to UV. So I would say adding cells at the last is actually better than mixing it with the polymer.
Okay, sir. So in scaffold design, topology optimization is a must know, sir.
It depends. So like what we do is we don't actually scan existing organs. So we actually create our own organs using mathematics and like modeling and stuff. So we don't do the scanning. So everything that we do is completely like we model it mathematically. So we can actually have any feature that we want. We can modify anything. So it's independent of the scan topology.
So can you give an example for anything, how you will be doing for a by using mathematical modeling, anything for as an example?
Yeah, so say you have a small a channel, a flesh channel that has a vasculature inside or like blood vessels inside. So how do you do that?
Okay.
So you scan it, you get a lot of noise, and I mean you wouldn't be able to get like a far high resolution model that you can print with. So what we
Yes,
do
sir.
is we actually use certain software. I mean I'm not like allowed to tell more because it's part of intellectual property.
Okay,
So
sure.
what we do is we make a solid tube and then create like phases and then use mathematical curvature equations to create those blood vessels and like subtract that from the primary object.
Yes, sir. Sir, whether you will be using any algorithms?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, okay, sir. Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah.
I have a question. Hello.
Yeah, sure. Hello.
Sir, actually, is there any hello?
Sir, this is
Yeah, go
Kanyu.
ahead. Sir, is there any limitation for the build volume that we are going to produce for
Yeah,
these vessels?
so definitely. So, I mean, yeah. So, like, it depends on what you want to print. So, like, any printer has its X, Y, and Z limitations. You can actually print within that. But so, for industrial grade like SLS and stuff, so companies actually customize the build volume to the customer needs. So, like, if you say you want like a meter cube print area, they can actually make it meter cube.
And one more question. Suppose if we use metal for printing process, we are using metal powders for
Yeah.
3D printing, then how do we protect the build part from oxidation and all?
Oh yeah, okay, so I actually missed out a point to say. So for metal printing, what they do is they completely keep the build volume and the whole stage inside inert gas atmosphere, usually argon. And then they don't expose it at all until it's taken out. So they print it, they move the whole assembly to the powder recovery, they recover the powder and then take the part out and put it into the sintering oven, and then the whole thing is vacuum or like inert, and then only after it is sintered they expose it to the.
Okay. After printing, how much time it will take for the complete solidification? Suppose if I use metal powder, say like aluminium or whatever aluminium, then how much time we will keep inside that chamber for complete solidification? Is there any criteria?
It depends on the alloy. So there are like
okay.
hundreds of materials and alloys. So each alloy has its own coalescing time or the furnace time. So yeah, so it depends on what material that you use. So aluminium, they have like maybe 50 or 60 types of metal powders that's mixed in Inconel or like anything. So yeah, it depends on the alloy type that you use.
Okay, that means we have to keep inside that chamber after the for the complete solidification process. That
yeah,
means
yeah,
it will that means it will take some more time to get it solidified, isn't it?
Exactly. So, so the last slide which I showed, the hydrodynamics. So this is actually the only technology that's being developed that doesn't need post curing, because
okay.
the part like with the, since you jet out molten material, so it hits it and it automatically solidifies, and you don't have to make it a solid. It's not a green part. So when it comes to SLS. So what do you get is actually a green part, and then you have to like put it in the sintering oven to completely solidify. And the bad thing about this is, say if you print a part at some size, so the part that you get out is actually much lesser than what you initially printed.
Sir, how do we control the temperature, build temperature? Suppose if we use polymer and all, then is there any controlling
Wait.
Over the temperature?
Polymer, I mean, I don't know how you use polymer with metals. I mean, are you talking about metals or you've moved on to
No. Metal.
Yeah, but I mean, I don't know if, no, there is no case where they use metal and polymers together.
No, sir. In metal printing, suppose if we use a metal powder, then how do we control the temperature? We are doing layer by layer, no?
Yeah.
So, is there if we are using laser, then we have to think of the power that we are using.
Oh yeah. So the spot power is actually you can actually modulate. So it depends for each metal. They have a set amount of spot power. So so what they do is when you do the slicing, all these parameters are being loaded onto the export file, which goes to the printer. So when that printer reads that file, so it reads all the variables that you give, and they say you have a laser power for first layer so and so. So the laser actually the beam actually
that means it will be displayed over the monitor, no?
In some cases, yeah. But I mean, I don't know like if they completely read it out, but usually you can do this in the slicing stage rather than monitoring it on the. You don't have to monitor; it's closed loop. It doesn't like change its power by its own. So so you just give it instructions and it just like follows.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Sir, can you prefer some of the bioprinters?
Bioprinters. Okay. So, so like, are you trying to print hydrogen scaffolds or like what are you trying to?
Hydroxyapatite.
I mean, is it hydrogel?
Yeah, hydrogel. Yes.
Okay. For hydrogel.
Hydrogel Wallerstein. Hydrogel Wallerstein.
Okay, so for any kind of like that, so what wavelength do you use for curing?
Sir.
What wavelength of UV that you use?
That we are not fixed so far, sir. It depends.
Okay. So yeah. So for this, you have like three wavelengths that generally people use. So you start with 365 and you can go all the way to like 405 nanometer. So I would say for printing that, there's a company called Volumetric in the US. So they make a printer which is called Lumen X.
Yes, sir.
Which is actually very good. So you get a XY resolution of 45 microns and a layer height of 20 microns. So you can print features on XY, which is 45 microns.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Any other questions? Yeah.
हेलो
Yeah.
सर, एक मतलब सर, ड्यूरिंग दिस कोरोना सर, वी आर यूजिंग फेस शील्ड
ஓகே
மணிகண்டன்
யூசிங் எப்பியம்
மணிகண்டன் இருற மணிகண்டன் ஃபுல்லா அடிக்கணுமா கேப்ஸ் ஃபர்ஸ்ட்
ஹலோ
யா கோ அஹெட் தேர்ஸ் லைக் டிஸ்டர்பன்ஸ்
ஹலோ சார் இஸ் இட் ஆடியபிள்
யா பட் யுவர் வாய்ஸ் லைக் வெரி லோ இட்ஸ் ஐ மீன் இட்ஸ் நாட் லவுட்
Yes, yes, sir. FPM machines we have used during this COVID facial
okay.
preparation.
Okay.
But what happened? Mass cannot possible in 3D printing. Mass production not possible.
Yeah, because mass is like a fabric, and you need like maybe 1 micron kind of pore size and stuff, which it's just not like yet possible, and you can't print fabrics with a printer. So I would
okay,
say,
okay.
Yeah.
What we faced that we need more number of quantity, but the time consumption of making up the component is taking more time.
Yeah, but you can actually print all the mechanical parts of the face shield and mask with that, but you still have to rely on like transparent plastics and like fabrics for the full construction.
Yes. So one more question, sir. Regarding that, can we customize for any metal printing machines? Or as a student, can we made it by purchasing of all the things, or is it required for any companies?
Yeah, I didn't get your point clearly. Did you
so can to? We can you make it a metal printing machine by own, sir?
Oh, metal printing machine by own. I mean, it's not worth doing it because you need like a lot of but you can do it, but you have to like make sure you don't infringe on any company's intellectual property and patent rights.
Yeah, that's why we are talking and seeing the all those things, but the time real time we are going to manufacturing or something, we are in the position of to buy from the other countries only. That's why I'm asking,
oh, yeah.
Is there any possibility of by giving off project to the students or any funded oriented? That's why I'm asking.
Yeah, you can definitely print like make a machine, but I mean, I'm not sure like how much resolution that you're gonna get with that, because the whole thing it needs to be kept in inert argon atmosphere, and there are like a whole lot of automation to be done to get it done. But I mean,
that's why I'm asking, is there any company or any foreign companies, like you are alumni of an institution, you have any company like they are giving
the 3D systems, they do metal 3D printing, and also you can contact EOS from EOS GmbH, they also do metal printing.
We are in the position for to develop more and more for 3D printing, sir. That's why I'm asking.
Okay.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Any other questions, sir? We'll wind up the session then.
All right, so thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
And like,
thank
please
you.
feel free to reach me out if you like need anything or any guidance or anything. I'm happy to help you. You all, see you.
Thank you, Akash, for your session. So very
right,
informative.
Thank you, Papa.
Right. Thank you. Thank you.
I think recording irukuda sir.
Recording illada.
Oh illa. Okay.
Arun Singh sir irukku sir. Kuduthukalam.
Irukka da? Ah okay da.
Ah irukku sir. Record aayit irukku. Kuduthukalam sir.
Ah sir. Chudunga.
Okay.
close it out.
ஹோஸ்ட் என் பண்ணிடுவாங்க சார், நம்ம விட்டுறலாம் அப்படியே.